Your praise is a weapon, and there's no God like our God. He's worthy of it. Let up a shout of praise to the Lord. Come on, clap those hands right here. Hey. Hey. Come on, lift your voice up. Hey.
I've searched the world, it couldn't satisfy. No one's ever gonna love me like you do. And every need, I know you will supply. That's just who you are, and that's just what you do. We lift your name higher and higher. Más y más alto te levantaré. We shout your praise louder and louder. Más y más fuerte.
be quiet. My God is alive.
Yes, yes.
How could I keep it inside?
Yes. Oh, yes.
I won't be quiet. My God is alive. How could I keep it inside? Oh, I won't be quiet. My God is alive. Yeah.
Yes, yes.
How could I keep it inside? So pray. Yeah. We got a reason to praise the Lord. I said we've got a reason to praise the Lord. I've got a reason to praise Him. Because something happens when I call the name of Jesus. Some of you missed it. I said something happens when I call the name of Jesus. Come on, demons tremble at that name. Yes, yeah. Mountains move at that name. Oh, yes. Come on. The same God of yesterday is the same God today. And if He did it before, He can do it again. Let's go, get it. Come on. Song. I'm here to tell you that this is your opportunity.
I wonder if we could put our hands together and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. My. It feels like church in the house. Because it is church in the house. Amen. As you make your way back to your seats, turn to the person beside you and tell them, I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise the Lord. Amen, amen. As you make your way back to your seats, I have a few announcements before you tonight before we move further in the service. Our announcement is we are packed out tonight for a Friday night of youth convention. Give yourself a hand clap for being here. Man, we want to thank each and every one of you for coming, worshiping with each and every one of us, and your support and love and prayers for our young people. And we believe that God has great and mighty things for the youth of the North Carolina district. Amen. Amen. If there is an empty seat, which there's not many, but if there is an empty seat in front of you, beside you, if you could scoot up and make room for some that may be standing room only, amen. And that's a good problem to have, amen. Jesus deserves a full house. Someone say rock and jump. Our rock and jump event at Friday night afterburner will begin at 10:30 tonight. Once again, we want to remind you that that jumpstart waiver must be signed by your parents in order to jump. Hopefully, you've gotten that approved and taken care of. We look forward to a great time of fun and fellowship at the Rock and Jump tonight. And we believe that everybody's going to stay safe and no one's going to get injured. And we're going to have a great time. Please remember our ministry expo taking place right outside the sanctuary. It will be open 45 minutes before or after service tonight. It highlights our AYC, our Bible quizzing, P7, CMI hyphen, and Move the Mission. Didn't we have a great Move the Mission kickoff rally? Wasn't that wonderful? And I'm excited about what the great young people of North Carolina are going to accomplish through Move the Mission. And I just believe that God can use you. Turn to the person beside you and tell them God can use you to make a difference around the world. Amen. Man, once again, I want to remind you of our quiet hours in the hotel. That is 10 p.m. to 7 a.m. And we appreciate you following that. And we know that the hotel staff appreciates that as well. If you could stand this evening, I have the high honor and privilege of introducing the district superintendent of the North Carolina district, Bishop Wayne Huntley. How many of you love our district superintendent? Man, we are so blessed in the North Carolina district with exceptional leadership. Last night, we had the opportunity to hear from our district secretary, Pastor Barnhill, and we once again had our opportunity to hear from him and his wife in our split session. They did such a great job. And I love Bishop Huntley. I've been told for as long as I can remember that our heroes are not to be our celebrities, sports stars, anybody of that nature, but our heroes are to be apostolic men and women of God. Amen? And I would, if you were to look up champion of truth, you would see Bishop Huntley's picture beside it. He is the ultimate champion of apostolic truth. Bishop Huntley, not only a phenomenal preacher of the gospel, but he's a great Christian, a man of great character and morals and integrity. And he serves and leads this great district of North Carolina with passion, vision, and supreme excellence. And I love you, Bishop. And I don't know where I would be without you. Would you put your hands together and welcome Bishop Huntley as he comes to greet you in Jesus' name.
Everybody said, praise the Lord. Shout, he's worthy of it all. And we give him the praise. God bless you. May be seated. Now you have to forgive Brandon. He's kind of prejudiced and blinded by his personal experience. But thank God for this generation of apostolics I got a few things to say and a short while to say it, and I'm just thrilled to be able to stand before you this evening. First thing I want to say is on behalf of our district board, Brother Barnhill, and all of our presbyters, you make this all worthwhile. You are our treasure. You are our joy. We love you, appreciate you, believe you, and have great faith in you. But let me say something quickly, even more powerful than that. You are hell's worst nightmare. Fired up, spirit-filled, blood-washed, passionate people of God are hell's worst nightmare. Clap your hands right now. Let the devil know God's got a great church. And they're not all old people. And you may be seated. My, what a phenomenal representation of the youth of the state of North Carolina here tonight. Let me pause just a moment. I feel that we'd be remiss and out of order. And you need to know this. I want Brother and Sister Richardson to stand, if they would. Missionaries from Madagascar. Wait just a minute. I want to tell you about them before you. When I get through talking about them, your applause will increase. I have been privileged to be in Madagascar. Remain standing. I've been privileged to be in Madagascar, preach a general conference there. Thousands and thousands of people, just as far as you could see. He told me, he said, now, don't worry about the altar call. You just preach whatever you want to preach. And he said, when you get through, 2,000 people is going to receive the Holy Ghost. I thought, you know what? Donald Duck could probably preach this meeting. He said, really, it don't matter what you preach. When you get through, turn it over to our workers, and 2,000 people are going to be filled with the Holy Ghost. When I got through preaching, over 2,000 people were filled with the Holy Ghost. These are some of the greatest missionaries in the United Pentecostal Church. Would you clap your hands and let them know you love them, you appreciate them? Thank God for our missionaries. And you may be seated. I was thinking about what I would like to say in this brief moment of greeting you, such a rare, high privileged opportunity. And I thought about this. In the book of Ruth, there is a few words written in Ruth chapter 1, verse 22. And it says, when Naomi and Ruth returned from Moabite, from the land of the Moabites, and came back to Bethlehem, there's a little phrase there that really ignited something in my spirit. It said, when they came back to Bethlehem, that it was the beginning of harvest. It was the beginning of harvest when they arrived. Now, I've had the Holy Ghost since I was 13 years old. As a young person, I was never privileged to be in a youth convention like this. As a matter of fact, when I was 13, you could put all the Pentecostals in the state of North Carolina in a room and it wouldn't be this many. But what I want to tell you is, I have watched this church in North Carolina go from season to season to season. From barrenness to fruitfulness, from dry, scorched, non-productive land, smallness, struggling, sacrificing. But today, I want to give you, as they sung, one more reason to praise the Lord. It's not just that you got to the church, it's when you got to the church. I want to say to you tonight, you got a reason to shout. Because you got here, you arrived in revival, in harvest. When you got here, the church was in harvest. Clap your hands and thank God for the great growth, the mighty revival, the outpouring of the Spirit. We're not small anymore in North Carolina. Clap your hands and shout thank God for it. And I celebrate that. So when you rejoice and praise God, don't just praise God because you got to the church. Praise God for when you got to the church. You got here in the midst of harvest, and I thank God for it. All over this building. Let's just do this quickly. How many are in this room right now? Young people primarily I'm talking about are students. How many of you received the Holy Ghost and got baptized in Jesus' name in the state of North Carolina? Would you stand? Woo! Pastors, you might want to stand up and take a look at this. My, oh my, oh my. That is absolutely marvelous. You know what that means? You got here at the right time. You got here at the time of harvest. And we celebrate that tonight. God bless you. You may be seated. We're going to ask our ushers to come and prepare to wait upon us this evening for a seed offering for Move the Mission. I want to congratulate our youth team, Brother Peavy, Brother Chance, and our sectional representatives for putting together a fabulous, spiritual, challenging, inspiring conference. Can you clap your hands and thank God for them? Look what they put together for you. Absolutely phenomenal. And I'm convinced you don't have to go far, I won't say much, but you don't have to go far from this room to know that our world desperately needs God. Our world desperately needs God. And what you're giving is for people to be baptized in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, and have their lives gloriously changed like yours. And I want to challenge you with this one more statement. How many of you are really thrilled? Have you ever thought about it? How many are really excited that you are, let me explain it, and then I'll ask you to clap your hands. How many of you really understand and you're excited that you're privileged to be on the giving side of evangelism? In other words, you're not somewhere out there in a bar tonight hoping somebody will send a preacher to you. You're not somewhere overdosing in drugs tonight hoping somebody would send a preacher to you. You're not somewhere way off in a dark place where there's not an apostolic preacher. So tonight, you have the privilege of being on the saving side of evangelism. Stand up and clap your hands and thank God for that. And so with that in mind, reach into your pockets and get something to serve as a seed for moving this mission. I'm not asking you to dump your billfolds tonight. I'm not asking you to empty your pockets tonight. But I'm asking you, everybody, give something. My mother trained my brother and me to give. When we went to church, we were poor as a proverbial Job's turkey, had nothing. But she said, you can't go to church without something to give. Sometimes it was a nickel. Sometimes it was a dime. Sometimes it was a quarter. But from that seed giving, we have been so blessed that I'm able to give to God now many, many more times than I used to make as my salary. And you got to start somewhere. Everybody say, you got to start somewhere. You can't give large until you start giving small. So you give where you are, and then someday your testimony will be the same as ours. God has blessed you. So get something to give tonight. If your friend's got more than one bill in their hand, jerk one out of his hand. Say, hey, wait a minute, don't be so stingy. Give me one of them. Let me have something putting this offer tonight. Practice on putting something in the offering, and you'll be blessed of God. Let me pray over you. Father, we're so grateful for this wonderful, wonderful youth convention and all these precious, powerful students that have gathered tonight declaring that they're not ashamed of you. They're not at all reluctant to declare their one God, Jesus' name, believe in holiness and separation from the world, and loving God. They're not ashamed of it. And they know this is the greatest life and the greatest blessing on planet Earth. So tonight, we give so that others can experience that power, that peace, and that wonderful life. And even more that we don't talk about enough, but is that eternal life with you on the other side as being a part of the bride of Christ. This is more than money, it's revival. It's more than money, it's salvation. It's more than money, it's deliverance. It's more than money. It's lives being changed. We give tonight to move this mission because it has moved us. And the assembly said in Jesus' name. God bless you as you give, my brother. Right here, behind you. Have y'all been marching or are you going through? March. All right. Come forward with the offering. Stay down here and give God some praise. They're going to sing another song. Lift up the name of the Lord. While they're gathering, worship with them.
Can you lift your hands all across the house? We're just going to sing one more song. And
we love you, Jesus. We worship you, Jesus.
You spoke those words, let there be light, and there was. In that same breath, stars fell in line with a voice, creation cry. You do all things well. You do all things well.
This is our prayer.
As you make your way back to your seats, give a great big hand for these worship leaders who do a splendid job. We have the greatest singers, the greatest musicians in all the world. Clap your hands if you appreciate the talent and the skill and the gifts that are in the United Pentecostal Church. give you just a moment to relocate. The youth team has extended to me the great honor and privilege tonight to introduce our speaker. So I'd ask all of you to stand in honor and respect of the man of God that will bring us the word of the Lord tonight. And let me just say this. A God-called man of God is not measured by years. The anointing that God puts upon his life and the investment that he makes in prayer and study and preparation elevates him far beyond years. And tonight we're very happy to have with us one of the most outstanding apostolic evangelists in the United Pentecostal Church. I think right now it'd be good for you if you would just acknowledge that our youth team, under the guidance of the district board, brings to you the very best that the United Pentecostal Church has to offer. Would you celebrate that with me just a moment? You're going to hear the very best. Sometimes people get the feeling in the church that nepotism, which is promoting your children above others, is the fact, the way that some men get to the pulpit. But let me just say this. In the event that you don't know it, it is more difficult for a preacher's son to become a preacher than it is for you coming from the outside and growing in the Lord. I can say that from personal experience. And besides this, remember this. It is said you can't keep a good man down. But here's what you need to remember. But neither can you keep a bad man up. So even when you get great chances, if you don't have it, you're not gonna maintain. You're not gonna take advantage of it. Our speaker tonight was born into the home of one of the most renowned conference, convention, camp meeting speakers in America. Could have been easy for him to have somewhat of intimidation, intrepidness about assuming the pulpit in the shadow of his father. But his father is a man of God who has raised many, many ministers for truth. Our speaker tonight brings with him a great life of conviction, consistency, compassion, a burden, a love, and a vision for the cause of God, who's invested himself in prayer, fasting, preparation to make his life a blessing to students all over America. I'm thrilled to bring to our pulpit tonight our guest evangelist, Reverend Nathan White.
Why don't we give God a great hand clap of praise right now? Come on, he's worthy of a great, great ovation. If you have your Bibles, turn to the book of Genesis, chapter 14. I want to again say what an honor it is to be invited to this great convention. Without a doubt, it is a highlight of my ministry to be able to preach at an event such as this. To all those that are responsible for me being here, thank you so much for the invitation. I don't say it because I have to. I don't say it with false humility, but it is truly humbling to stand on this platform and preach to this congregation. To Bishop Huntley, there is no one quite like him. Of course, to your superintendent, your district board, to Brother Peavy, the executive team, the youth committee, to all of those great guys, thank you so much for letting me be here, for the hospitality, the fellowship. So many men here, I'll get in trouble. One, because I can't see you now because the lights are in my face, but I'll get in trouble if I start trying to name names. But so many men that I admire, that I love, that I respect, And to my bishop, my pastor, the greatest men of God that's ever walked the face of this earth, I give them great honor tonight. And I didn't take the time to do it last night, but I want to take the chance to do it tonight. To every student pastor, youth worker, and chaperone, I give you honor tonight and thank you for putting in the work. To every young person that's here, thank you for showing up. If it wasn't for you, we'd be a bunch of middle-aged and old people. It wouldn't be youth convention. So thanks for showing up and making it a youth convention. It would just be a convention, but just a bunch of old people. Young people, I give you honor. Whether you came because your parents said you have no choice, or you came because you needed a move of God, thank you for showing up. I've enjoyed my time here with you, and I hope tonight my contribution to this meeting will somehow help not just individuals, but youth groups, hopefully churches. I come tonight with a heavy burden with what the Lord's laid on my heart to do. I realize you've been standing for a while. You've been jumping and worshiping, but you're going to sit down in a minute, and I'm going to stay standing, so just hang on. Genesis chapter 14 and verse 11. And they took all the goods of Sodom and Gomorrah and all their victuals and went their way. And they took Lot, Abram's brother's son, who dwelt in Sodom, and his goods, and departed. And there came one that had escaped and told Abram that the Hebrew, for he dwelt in the plain of Mamre, the Amorite, brother of Eshcol and brother of Aner, and these were confederate. And when Abram heard that his brother was taken captive, he armed his trained servants, born in his own house, 318, and pursued them. And he divided himself against them, he and his servants, by night, and smote them, and pursued them unto Hobah, which is on the left hand of Damascus. And he brought back all the goods, and he brought again his brother Lot and his goods, and the women and the people. Skip down to verse 21 for our final scripture tonight. Verse 21 says, and the king of Sodom said unto Abram, give me the people and take the goods for yourself. Tonight, I hope to impact the life of every individual, and even if in some small way. No one is excluded from hearing the word of the Lord tonight. We're going to have an apostolic move of God tonight. I got to be honest with you. Hang on. I got to be honest with you. I told Brother Peavy last night, I said, there will be an opportunity for the gifts of the Holy Ghost to flow in this convention. There will be a prophetic utterance that begins to move. There will be an impartation that happens at some point in this service. And I believe that God wants to do it tonight. Would you lift up your hands, lift up your voice, ask God to touch us, help him, ask him to help us to prepare our hearts and our minds right now. Come on, let's pray the way apostolics know how to pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. Why don't you clap your hands to the Lord as you're seated? Man, didn't this worship team do an incredible job this week? All these musicians. Thank you so much. You made my job easier. Give it up for Brother Gideon, man. This is one of the coolest dudes in the whole world. That's a cool dude right there. Brother Latouche, all these guys, y'all are just incredible. Thank you so much for everything that you've done. Our text tonight brings us the first and only military action that you will ever find Abram engaged in. Oddly enough, this action is not of his own doing or his own ambition. Rather, the entire episode is played out. The battle is fought due to his goodwill and tender heart toward the people around him. This battle is not to enrich himself or bring fame to his reputation. The battle was fought for someone else. Some would say that there has never been a military expedition undertaken, prosecuted, and finished more honorably than Abram's battle in the 14th chapter of Genesis. The king of Sodom and his allies were beaten and killed by the sword, and those that lived and survived fled to the mountains for safety. But the king that had attacked Sodom took those that they could capture, and they took all of their goods. They plundered the city, took the stores and the provisions. As the conquerors of Sodom, they carried away the spoils of war. We see that Lot and his family were taken as prisoners and victims of this war. They took his belongings, his household, and they paraded them as prisoners of this war. Yes, it is the same Lot that you are thinking of. Just one chapter before, Lot had been living in the camp with Abram. He had just previously been enjoying the bountiful blessings that come with living a righteous and holy life. He had known what it was like to see the miracles and the provisions of God for those that he loved. But now Lot finds himself a prisoner of war. We could say that Lot just got caught up at the wrong time, at the wrong place, with the wrong people. He just happened to share with his neighbors in their common calamity. After all, we could argue at this point that Lot is still trying to be a righteous man, but he was involved with the rest of Sodom. And so as trouble comes to Sodom, so comes the troubles for those that have decided to live there. The best of men cannot compromise and expect an exemption from the troubles that come to this world. When you are living in the middle of Sodom, you cannot expect the troubles that come knocking at your neighbor's door to skip over you and go on to somebody else and to play fair. Wisdom says, separate yourself from those that are not living right. Separate yourself from those that have always got issues and strife and problems and all kinds of controversy. Get away from those things. Make sure you have distance in your world. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 says, "And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For you are the temple of God. As God said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." He didn't say they should be our people. He didn't say he would share you, young person, but you are God's. You are his. He's selfish with you. Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. I come tonight to North Carolina to tell you, there comes a point in the life of every Christian, whether you claim to be apostolic or some other denomination, that you are going to have to separate yourself from the world. There's going to come a point, I don't care your religious preference, I don't care your political party, I don't care your race or your ethnicity, when it comes to living for God, there are just some things we cannot allow ourselves to do. There are some things we can't allow ourselves to get involved in. Separate yourself. Get out of those things. Get away from those things. If it doesn't look holy, you shouldn't be involved in it. If it doesn't feel... Don't wait on your pastor to preach against it. Get a conviction of your own. If it don't feel right, it's probably not right. Oh, come on, somebody help me tonight. I believe, hear me. I believe that we should be separate and holy people. I believe that we should not look like the world. We shouldn't talk like the world. We shouldn't act like the world. We should be different from the world. Come on now. I fear that if we are not careful, we are allowing the culture of the world to get into the culture of the church.
I'm going to be honest with you. Everybody says, well, you shouldn't talk about holiness. You shouldn't touch standards, isn't it? Can I tell you that holiness is not a standard? Holiness is a biblical absolute. It's a part of your salvation. It's a part of living for God. There's some things we don't put on. There's some places we don't go. There's some things we don't do. There's some things we don't get involved in. I'm afraid, Brother Peavy, that we are allowing the culture of the world to start influencing the Christian culture and to influence our church culture. Hang on to me now. I need to explain what I'm saying. We should be different from the world, but I fear that if we are not careful, we are allowing the culture of the world to blend and blur the lines with the culture of the church. Look at it. There are major issues everywhere we turn. There are major things going on in our world. Every time, everyone believes that everything is a conspiracy. Everybody believes that everybody is working an angle, and that's why you're skeptical of even what I'm preaching, because you're waiting on the other shoe to drop. That's why the church and the man of God have to try to prove that this apostolic experience is real. It's not just enough to preach it. We got to try to prove it now. Society is rebelling against anything and everything resembling authority. And then we sit and wonder why our saints don't want to be submitted to a man of God or submitted to youth directors or submitted to authority in our church. Hey, I'm gonna walk this road whether you like it or not. All right, Bishop, if I'm out of line, you know I'm submitted to you. You stop me. But we got people in our churches, people all over this world. We're triggered or we're offended or we're hurt or we're upset by or things trigger something and we relive and we re-God. And we got all these terms and we want people to live their truth. Can we normalize being normal? All right, but then we want to come to church, and Bishop, we try to figure out why we move churches every time we get upset or we get offended. It's because we're not loyal to anybody. We're not loyal to a man of God. We're not loyal to a church. We're not loyal to the Spirit of God. We move and we want to claim church hurt, and we want to say, well, I was triggered and I was upset and I was hurt by the pastor. No, you weren't triggered. He just preached against your sin and you felt convicted. And instead of doing right, you decided to move on down the road to somebody that would tickle your ears and make you feel good about your sin. The preacher preaches conviction and tells you to quit fornicating. The preacher preaches conviction and tells you to quit looking at those things and quit acting a certain way and quit doing. And instead of admitting that we were wrong, we say, well, I'm triggered by that kind of preaching. It bothers me. It should bother you. I don't ever want to get numb to conviction. I don't ever want to get used to conviction. But it doesn't stop there. It doesn't stop there. We love to preach about coming out from among them. It's our candy stick. We love to preach. It preaches good. It's fun to preach. But the Bible still says, what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? Can I tell you tonight, apostolic young people, that if we are not careful, we are guilty of idolatry in our churches? Oh, yeah, we can. We won't go to certain events unless the right big name preachers preach. We won't go to certain youth rallies if the right name's not going to be there. We don't care about the preaching. We just want to get the hashtag. We just want to get the selfie. Oh, let me come down here where I can see you. We'll share certain things on social media that you don't even know if you believe because you're too shallow to understand it. But because the name is right, you'll share it so that you seem like you're in the in crowd. Do I offend you because I speak the truth? We won't go. Oh, help me now, Lord. I'm about to, if you ain't mad, you're fixing to jump on board with all those that are. We won't go to youth rallies and we won't go to youth convention unless the right worship artist is leading. Brother, I wish I knew who you were, Brother White. You're saying all that, and y'all just got done praising all these people, and you just got done. Hey, there is a difference in preacher worship and God worship. I can take you to points in Texas district where your bishop of this district preached in Texas that changed my life. He's an incredible man, but I don't worship the man. I honor him. I respect him, but I worship the God. Can someone please explain to me what a worship artist is? Last I heard, he was the artist, and we are the canvas. If we're not careful, we can start praising men, and we can create our own idolatry. Why? Because we want the next big thing. We want the fad. We are going to make our own apostolic idols out of people that God has anointed and people that God has given talents to. But then we wonder why they crumble and make shipwreck of their world when we're done idolating him. Hey, I'm not pointing fingers at anybody tonight. I'm related to two of the people. Bethany and David got more talent in their little finger than I got in my whole body. But we're not going to make an idol out of them. It's so tight right now. I'm going to win you back here in just a moment. But can I tell you, I don't care whose name is on the flyer. I don't care what artist is coming to sing. What I want to know is, are we going to have a move of God? Are we going to have a, is God going to show up? I don't care who else shows up. I just want God to show up. I don't care what big name is there. I just want God to be there. Is my life going to be changed? Is my world going to be turned? Oh, help us, God. Come out, come out, come out. Be the apostolics that God has called us to be. Fall in love with the move of God, not with a person entertaining you. Fall in love with the touch of God, not some big fancy title. Fall in love with the presence of God. Fall in love with the Word of God. I don't really care, Bishop, who's preaching it. I just want to hear a word from the Lord. I want to hear what thus saith the Lord. I want to hear somebody change my life. I want to hear somebody tell me when I'm wrong. Fall in love with God. And so Lot has been taken prisoner with those from Sodom. But a man escapes and runs to where Abram is. And he finds him and he says, Abram, you need to know they come in and they took your brother. We know that Lot was actually the nephew of Abram, but this Sodomite comes and finds Abram living outside the city. Remember this, he was outside the city. The world had to come find him. He knew the bond between brethren. So he comes to Abram and he says, the world took your brother. Can I tell you that he was probably one of the worst Sodomites there are? He was probably a filthy ranked sinner, but when times got tough, he knew where to go to find a man of God. He knew where to go to find an answer for his situation. Hey, I need to tell a church. I need to tell a pastor here tonight. Don't move, Abram. Stay right where you are, because when the world falls apart around them, they're going to come looking for a preacher that still preaches truth. They're going to come looking for somebody that's not letting down and not letting go and not giving up. And so Lot's taken captive. He comes and tells him, Brother Peavy, they took your brother. Watch what Abram does. Abram turns and goes home, and he arms 318 servants of his own household. Sounds pretty cool. Sounds really rebellish. Sounds very cool to say, yeah, he goes home, he arms them. My question is this. If this is the only military action that Abram ever engaged in, why have 318 trained servants? When he handed them the spear, they did not stick it in the ground and think it was a walking staff. When he handed them the shield, they did not think that it was a serving platter. When he handed them a sword, they did not flip it around and wonder, what do I? But no, when he armed them, when he commissioned them, here's what we got to see. When they were there, their primary job may have been taking care of the fields. Their primary job may have been cleaning the house and making sure everything was ready to go. But when the master walked in and said, hey, we got something we got to go handle. I need you to go to bat. There was no question about, can I tell some young people here tonight, your primary job may be to keep yourself saved, but when the king comes in, if it matters to him, it matters to me. If it's important to him, it's important to me. When he says it's time to fight, we don't sit back and wonder, how long do I have? But when it's time to go to battle, give me a sword, give me a spear, give me a shield. I'll go to battle, I'll go to war, whatever you need me to do, master. Yes, sir, whatever you ask of me, I'll go to battle. I'll get out of my comfort zone. I'll get out of what I'm used to doing, and we're going to have a move of God. Understand with me tonight, the Bible says he armed his trained servants. There was no question. Here goes Abram, 318 men. They pursue the four kings, and the Bible says that Abram and his servants attacked them and smite them. Abram brought back all the goods. He brought back all his brother Lot, the women and his goods and all the people. Abram has now defeated four kings and their armies with a little more than 300 men that are used to working the fields and sweeping the house. What an entire city could not do, Abram done with a few determined servants, a few people that said, I'll do whatever the master wants me to do. I'll go wherever the master asks me to go. I want to do and I want to be whatever he calls me to be. But what we must see happens next, for it's within the words of these verses that we will find the reason Abram made the decision that he made. Verse 21 says that the king of Sodom tells Abram, you can have all the goods that you recovered. Just give me the people. Sodom was telling Abram, you can have all the spoils of war. Just leave the people with me. I don't really care about the stuff. The stuff does not matter. I just want the people. I don't really care about all the things that they got with. I don't care about the baggage. I don't care about the things that are in the wagons. All I want are the people. The king of Sin City was telling Abram, you can have everything else, but give me the souls. And here we find the reason that Abram would go to war for his brother. Abram realized the stuff does not matter. The spoils do not matter. How they got there doesn't matter. The reason they ended up where they are, it doesn't really matter. Because when it comes right down to it, all that matters in this life are the souls. In other words, Abram was saying, Lot, I don't agree with what's going on, but you're worth fighting for. I don't know how you got there, but I'm going to fight for you. You matter to me. In the only recorded battle that Abram was ever a part of, it was for the soul of his brothers and his sisters. In his only recorded battle, it wasn't for Abram wasn't trying to build his reputation as a great warrior. No, this single battle in the resume of Abram was for the soul of his brother. Abram realized there are some things that are still worth fighting for. I have been sent to this pulpit tonight with one single purpose in this service, and that is to remind this great congregation that your brothers and your sisters are still worth fighting for. Last night, God wanted us to reach inward, and God wanted us to reach lost souls. But tonight, the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, I don't want them just reaching lost souls, but I want them reaching across the aisle. I want them reaching across the auditorium, because the souls of their brothers and their sisters matter. Yeah. I've come tonight under a heavy burden of the Holy Ghost. There may be some that are struggling. There may be some that are considering walking away. No doubt, I feel it in my spirit. There is an evangelist. You are exhausted in mind and spirit. There are pastors and pastors' wives that are wondering how much longer you're going to be able to hold on. Hey, student pastor. Hey, youth worker. I know you're wondering, is all this still worth it? Can I still keep going? But I've got a word from God for you tonight. You matter to us. You're important to the kingdom. You're worth fighting for. For those of you that are weary, for those of you that are wondering how much more you can take, for the group of people that are trying to figure out why you must endure the things that you are enduring, for the ones that feel ashamed and you try to hide the pain and the frustrations, for the ones that have been considered giving up and walking away, for the young person, for the youth worker, for the man of God. To the pastor's kid that considered walking away from everything before you got to youth convention this weekend, I come to tell you, I got good news for you. There's an entire auditorium full of people that think you're worth fighting for. It matters not to us how long you've been in the struggle. It doesn't matter to us how much baggage you're carrying with you. You are worth fighting for. You matter to the church. We need to only look at the story of Saul of Tarsus to know that God loves you regardless of where you're at or what you're going through. Oh yeah, we only need to look at his life and his conversion, because it was in Acts chapter 9 that Ananias was awakened and sent to go pray for this man. Watch what happens in Acts chapter 9 in verse 11. And the Lord said unto him, arise and go into the street which is called Straight. The reason why some of you can't be used of God is because you refuse to walk the straight and narrow. So they walk into the street called Straight and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth and hath seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias, watch what Ananias does. Ananias answers and says, I've heard by many about this man, how much evil he hath done to thy saints. And here he hath the authority from the chief priests to bind all that call on your name. But the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles. Watch verse 16. And I will show him how great a things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and putting his hands on him said, brother Saul. Ananias was told to go find Saul, a man that he had never laid eyes on, but he had heard all the dirt about. Ananias went to find somebody he had never personally met, but he had heard all the bad things about. He had heard about how he doesn't like church and how he doesn't like the preacher and how he heard all the bad things there were to hear about him, Brother Peavy. He heard all the things there were to say about him. He never experienced it for himself. But then Ananias is awakened in the middle of the night by a dream that he's supposed to go pray for this man. He had never heard of Saul ever wanting to show up to Easter weekend. He never one time went to North Carolina Youth Convention. Ananias never one time seen Saul at an altar call on his own. And yet he walks up. Come here, Bubba, right there on the end. Come here. On the end. There we go. It's hard to get good help these days. But watch what happens. You're blind. You're blind. No, you're blind. Watch what Ananias does. He walks in. The first thing he does, Ananias wrestles with this burden. He fights with it. He fights with this burden. He wrestles with it all night. He finally gets up and does as God instructed him to do. He walks in, Sister Ballester, he walks in. And the first thing he does is he lays his hand on that shoulder and says, my brother, Saul. Wait a minute. Wait a minute, Pastor Ananias. Saul hadn't been through the 12-step program yet. Saul hasn't been perfected by our discipleship programs yet. Saul doesn't know how to dress right, and he still looks a wretched wreck, and he still looks all kinds of crazy, and he don't know how to comb his hair, and he's got all kinds of problems. He got all kinds of issues. Don't you know? Wait, why would you call him brother? Let me tell you why. Because Ananias realized there are some things more important than making sure we beat him into shape. He walks in and he says, Saul, I don't know much about you that I know of. I've never seen you. But Saul, I need you to know I've been fighting for you all night. I've been wrestling a burden for your soul all night. I need you to know I don't understand why you're here. I don't know why you're going through the things you're going through. I don't know what happened in your life that led you down this road. But Saul, I need you to know you matter. You matter to the church. You matter to the preacher. You matter to the youth. Hear me tonight. We got to get to the point that God can burden us. We got to get to the point that God can lay someone on our heart. He tells Saul, I need you to know you're worth 100 sleepless nights. I'll take 1,000 battles if it means one soul being saved. And yet, some of you are still skeptical. So let me take you back to the conversation that Ananias had with God. Verse 11, God tells Ananias, I want you to go find Saul. Watch what he says. Can you put that verse back up there for me? He goes and he tells him, he says, Ananias, I want you to go find Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayed. You mean the one that acts like they could care less about being apostolic? You mean the freak show walking around acting like they're crazy and demonic and all kinds of crazy things? You mean that? Yeah, I mean that person. I mean the ones that are sitting on these pews tonight that are wondering if they're ever going to make it. They've been praying for somebody to come lay their hands on them and let them know that they're important. I echo my words from earlier in this message when I tell you that I have come for one single purpose. I have been sent to remind North Carolina that you are still worth fighting for. You've got to hear the heart of this preacher when I tell you, there are people in this service that have been praying that God would send someone into their world. There are people in your city. There are people at your jobs. There are people in your schools that are saying, send somebody to my world. There are backsliders that act like they hate your guts, but they're praying. They're screaming out at night. Tears are running down their face, and they're saying, God, send somebody into my world. I need to know you're real. You may have never spoken to them before, but I promise you they're praying. They don't know how to pray perfect prayers. They don't know how to do it all the right way. It is high time that this generation decide, I'll carry the burden for somebody else. I'll carry a burden for someone I don't know. I'll carry a burden for another young person, for another youth group. I got to be honest with you today. I got to be honest with you tonight. I felt the Holy Ghost after what an incredible message we heard this morning by our youth president. What an amazing job that he done. But I got to be honest with you. I walked across the front, Brother Peavy, and I began to pray with people. I began to pray with young adults, and I began to pray with kids, and I watched as tears begin to run down their face. I watched, I begin to pray with different ones, and I hope to God I can find you tonight so I can let you know that you're the one I'm talking about. But I stood right there in front of that front row this morning. The Holy Ghost spoke to me. He said, there is a heaviness in this convention, but it is not a weight of sin. It is not a weight, and it is not a heaviness of walking away from God. He said, but the adversary has laid weights on this generation and in this district that God never intended for them to carry. I mean, tonight, as I say this as submitted as I know how to be, there are churches, there are ministries, there are youth groups in this congregation. Some of you are carrying the weight of feeling inadequate for the call that God has placed placed on your life. You're carrying the weight of fear and anxiety and worry. Even though you know that God has spoke to you, you're here tonight and you're trying to figure out, where do I fit in? Where do I belong? What am I supposed to do? I feel all these things, but I feel so inadequate. It's so heavy. I don't even feel like I can make it to an altar call. I don't know how much longer I can make it, preacher. I don't feel like I'm doing anything for God. Hey, preacher, I'm the youth director, and yet I still feel like I'm not being effective. Hey, evangelist, I need you to hear me tonight. You matter. There's still room for you in the house. You're still important to the kingdom of God.
Lift your hands all across this auditorium right now. The Holy Ghost is trying to step in and begin to take over.
You hear me in the Holy Ghost. Stay very sensitive to the Holy Ghost. God's going to step in. He can take over at any time that he wants to. You hear me in the Holy Ghost, though. I'm going to tell you what I felt the Holy Ghost speak to me as I was making my way to this convention. As I was flying through the air, the Holy Ghost began to speak to me and began to talk to me about what would happen on this Friday night. I'm going to tell you some of your biggest problem. Hey, I say this respectfully to every minister. I say it respectfully to every youth worker and everybody in between. The biggest thing that you deal with is not sin. The biggest issue you have is not feeling like you're not good enough. The problem that we have is we have allowed the adversary to isolate us from one another. Hang on, listen to me. Hang on. No, hang on. You got to feel the heart of what I'm trying to say. We have allowed the adversary to draw lines of division, to draw lines of separation amongst us.
Hell's doing a good job of destroying. No. Hell's good at what it's doing, but we're doing a lot better at dividing ourselves than hell is. Well, I don't like the way they do, but is their soul still not important? I don't know if I agree with, but is their soul still important? I don't know if I like that, but does the soul still matter? Because if the soul really matters to us, all the stuff doesn't matter. I am not giving permission to those that have compromised and gone charismatic and walked away from this precious truth. I'm not giving way for that, but what I am saying is this: we better love the soul of every individual, whether we agree or disagree. We gotta love the soul. You matter. Your youth group matters. You're important. But I don't even know your name, but you're important. You need to know that the kingdom of God needs you. The kingdom of God wants you. I don't know where you're from. I don't know your youth group. I don't know your name. But the kingdom of God wants you to do a great thing. God wants to do good things. But it can't happen if you remove yourself and you isolate. Sin is a big problem, and yes, we got to get over it, but isolation is a bigger issue. Lines of division are a bigger issue. Things are a bigger issue than what we are allowing God to heal within us. Hey, youth committee, this is probably one of the greatest youth committees I've ever been around. There's a unity here. There's a cohesiveness here, but you want me to tell you how to ruin it? Let politics get in the way. You want to sabotage revival in this district and in this youth group? Let yourself start posturing and start pushing for position. Start trying to get in the way and start talking and start trying to give things out and start trying to spread dirt on people. come tonight not just to gripe and not just to complain. Hey, I got to be honest with you tonight. The Holy Ghost spoke to me in my hotel room on my way here and said that there was a pastor's kid that was considering walking away from God tonight. Why? Because you feel inadequate. You feel insignificant. You feel like you don't belong. You feel like you constantly live in the shadow of everyone around you. I feel the Lord is challenging the spirit of complacency and comparison amongst our churches. Hear me in the purest way I know how to say this. The feeling of inadequacy and feeling like if we aren't effective and feeling like we can't change the world and feeling like we can't do things that God has called us to do. Pastor, I need you to hear me. Your effectiveness does not depend on the size of your congregation. Youth director, hear me. I don't care if you've got the biggest youth group here or if you've got two young people in your youth group. You are making an impact in the kingdom of God. The feeling of inadequacy and feeling like we aren't effective unless we achieve a certain number or a certain status in our movement. Ministers and ministries are being marketed and manipulated to fit an entertainment mentality instead of what God has intended for them to be. We have to reach a place that we look at our brothers and sisters in the church and remind them, you're worth it. We have to reach the place that we can allow God to burden us for people that we don't even know. Tell them you're worth fighting for. You may not be living the exact way you're supposed to be living. You may be wondering how much more you can take. You may be wondering how things are ever going to start moving back the right direction. I need to preach to someone who was on the edge of backsliding tonight. I need to preach to a preacher's kid who you're already addicted to things and your parents don't even know about it. But I need you to know, if you don't feel like anybody else cares, you need to hear this preacher. I care about you all the way in Texas. I believe in you. I'll pray for you. I fought a burden for weeks now. Why? Because you matter to me. You matter to the kingdom of God. The adversary has attacked your mind and you're wondering if all this is still worth it. I need to tell an evangelist, it's not worth laying down and walking away. It's not worth giving up your card and walking out. It's not worth compromising the message. You belong here. You're doing a good work here. I need to tell a pastor that it feels like you're fixing to lose. I need to tell a preacher's wife, you feel like you're going to lose your mind. You're important, and we need you. This generation needs you. It's a lie. It is a lie from hell that you are not effective. You may be looking, hey, young person, you may be looking at the land of Sodom. You may be looking to what's easier, what's better, what's more seeker-friendly, young preacher. How long do I keep fighting this fight? My brothers, my sisters, you're worth fighting for. I know it's hard, but keep pushing. You can make it. I know it's difficult, but keep going. You can make it. I need you to hear the voice of God tonight. You're not fighting this alone. We'll fight through the stuff. We don't mind fighting around some of the issues that you may have because the baggage doesn't matter. The wagon loads of issues do not matter. We don't care about the stuff. We care about the soul. You know what we need tonight? We need preachers. We need youth committee members. We need youth directors that'll pray with other youth directors. It doesn't matter to me if you're in the same church or on opposite ends of the district. It doesn't matter to me if you have the biggest youth group here or if you're the only young person in your church. We don't care if you see everything the way we see it. We don't care if it all matches up perfectly. We don't care how deep the wound is. You're worth fighting for. We don't care how dark the thoughts are. We don't care how long you've been battling suicide. We don't care how terrible. We don't care how bad the depression. You are worth fighting for. It doesn't matter if you've already backslid. It doesn't matter if you're already in sin. It doesn't matter if you've already let go. You matter. You matter. You matter. You're worth fighting for. You're worth fighting for. We don't care about the stuff. We don't care about the why. We don't care about the how. We don't need the history. Come on. Come on, in a service like this, nobody should be praying by themselves. In an atmosphere like this, nobody should be fighting by themselves. We need to grab a hold of each other and fight with our brothers, fight with our sisters. Come on. Last night, God told us to get ourselves right. Last night, God told us to get ourselves pure, to get our spirit right. But tonight, you need to reach across the aisle. Hey, preacher, some of you need to reach across the city limit sign. Some of you need to reach across the district and say you matter. I'm sorry for the church hurt. I'm sorry for the issues. I'm sorry for what I said. You matter. You matter. You matter. It doesn't matter if you look like me. It doesn't matter if you pray the way I pray. All that matters to me is that you make it to heaven. All that matters to me is that you dance on streets of gold beside me. Come on, this isn't going to be no small altar call. This doesn't need to be a patty cake prayer. There needs to be a burden. The Holy Ghost is here. There will be a moment of impartation in just a moment. There is going to be a shift in the spirit world here in just a few minutes. But we got to get our mind right. We got to get our spirit right. We got to get our heart right. Come on, find somebody to pray with. Oh, God, help us. Feel a burden for somebody. But I don't know them. That's fine. They're still your brother. I don't know their name. That's fine. The Holy Ghost spoke to you and told you to pray for them.